Hello everyone. Today we are going to take a topic that is basics of cell and cell membrane. The subject is cellular biochemistry and it is a subject and unit is 1. Now first of all we learn about the cell theory. The cell theory basically is made up of 3 basic components that are 1. The first rule is that all organisms are made up of one or more cells. This theory was done by Sheldon and Squon in the year 1838 to 1839. The second rule is the cell is a basic, fundamental and structural unit of living things. All the living things are made up of cell and cell is the basic and the structural and the functional unit of the living organism. This was also done by the same scientist. And the third cell theory that was derived was that all cells are produced by the division of pre-existing cells. This means that all cells are produced from other cells. No cells are produced spontaneously. Now the modern cell theory. The modern cell theory is also mainly made or derived from the same cell theories that were described earlier. Modern cell theory contains 4 statements in addition to the original cell theory. Let's look at the 4 statements. The cell contains hereditary information, DNA, which is passed on from one cell to the another during cell division. Means through DNA, DNA that is the genetic material, it is passed from one cell to the other cell. All cells are basically the same in chemical composition and metabolic activities. If you compare all the cells of all the living organism, you can see that they all are similar in one way or the other. All basic chemical and physiological functions are carried out inside the cell. All basic functions are like movement of the cell, the digestion that occurs in the cell, that is our process of phagocytosis. They all occur inside the cells. Cell activity depends on the activity of the subcellular structure, that is the organelles that is within the cells, for example, nucleus, plasma membrane, mitochondria, etc. Now the endosymbiotic theory, this was delivered by American biologist, that is Lynn Margulis, as you can see, provided the evidence that some organelles that are present in the cell are derived from outside. They were like the prokaryotic bacteria which were present outside the cell and now are considered as an organelle that lives inside the cell. The supporting evidence included the organelles inside the cell that has their own DNA, that is one is a mitochondria and the second one is a chloroplast. The endosymbiotic theory was like from time when there was a prokaryotic bacteria, it developed then into a eukaryotic bacteria, that is a nice nucleus was developed, plasma membrane was developed, the ER was developed. And then what happened as the time passed, the 2 prokaryotic bacteria, that was a mitochondria and chloroplast, they were present outside the cell. So what happened? The bacteria, eukaryotic bacteria engulfed this mitochondria. They engulfed the mitochondria because and started living symbiotically. That is why this theory is known as endosymbiotic theory. So what happened? The mitochondria that was present, it started giving energy to the cell and the cell in opposite direction started giving shelter to the mitochondria and the same cell engulfed the chloroplast and the chloroplast it has chlorophyll which can perform the photosynthesis and thus it started giving these bacteria these cells the food and the cell in order gave them shelter. So this became the eukaryotic plant cell and the one which did engulfed only mitochondria became the eukaryotic animal cell. This is the basic structure of the cell. As you can see, these are all the organelles, microfilaments, centriole, nucleus, the ribosomes. This is the nucleus, main thing, lysosomes, Golgi apparatus, rough endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria and smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Now let us review the facts about the living organisms. What are the main characteristics of an organism? The organisms are all made up of the cell according to the cell theory. It requires energy. All organisms require energy in form of food. It reproduces, that is the species reproduce, means they produce their own offspring. They maintain homeostasis. Homeostasis means the balanced condition with the environment. They are always in their balanced equilibrium state. They are all organized. Organized means they have a very organized system, organ system, tissue. They all form in a very organized state. They respond to the environment means they have a connection with the environment and they respond to the environment. They grow as well as develop. According as our offspring is born, they grow. The cells divide, they grow in height, weight, and they develop. And then the exchange of materials with the surrounding occurs, that is the waste materials, the waste gases, etc., exchange with the environment. Now, characteristics of all the cells are, cell has mainly three main parts, that is a surrounding membrane, that is a plasma membrane, the protoplasm, that is the cell contains in thick fluid, the organelles, that is the structures for the cell function, organelles are the mitochondria, etc., and the control center within the DNA. This is the staining slide of a cell. Now, cell size and types. Cell, the basic units of organism, can only be observed under microscope because they are microscopic. Three basic types of cells are there, that is the animal cell, plant cell, and the bacterial cell. This is the chart that shows the cell size. The smallest cell is DNA, poliovirus, then comes the HIV virus and T4 bacteriophage, then the E. coli, human red blood cell, then neurons of the body which are quite larger, then the typical plant cell that is largest, and the hen's egg. Egg is the largest cell in the world. So this is the chart that shows the sizes of the cell. It ranges from 5 to 50 micrometers or microns in diameter. Now, cell size. When the surface area of the cell is no longer greater to get enough to get rid of all the waste material or to capture enough food, the cell has to divide so that the surface area increases. After they mature, they don't have enough surface area so that they can release the waste materials or capture enough food. Therefore, the cells of an organism are close in size. This cell is the largest, is the plant cell, then the animal cell, and then comes the bacterial cell, which is the smallest because it is the prokaryotic type of cell. Now, multicellular organism. Cells in multicellular organism often specialize, that is, they take on different shapes and functions. Multicellular organism means those organisms that have more than one cell. So they have different types of cell, that is different in structure as well as functions. As you can see, the cells are can be of skin, bone, kidney, blood, heart, muscles, pancreas, livers, etc. Now, cell specialization. Cells in the multicellular organism, they actually differentiate. What is differentiate? They become specialized by turning on different genes on and off. This is known as differentiation. Means from the one cell, the whole other cells are formed. Different cells means neuron cells, blood cells, muscle cells, all the extra cells are by the method of differentiation, by genes turning on and turning off, they are formed. Now, the specialized cells are the muscle cells of our body. These are the pictures, the red blood cells and the cheek cells, which are stained. Now, specialized plant cells. The plant cells is also a multicellular organism and a eukaryotic organism. They also have specialized tissues or cells, means they are different from the other cells. That is the guard cells, the xylem cells from where the water passes, and the pollen cells. The pollens are present in the anther and are used for pollination and the fertilization techniques of the plants. Now, organization levels of the life. Let's see from atoms to organism. How from atoms the whole organism can be formed. In the level of organization in non-living things is, they are first made up of atom. Atom in Greek, it means indivisible. It is the smallest unit of everything. So from atom that forms the element, it forms a molecule. Molecule are compounds like carbohydrates, proteins. Means when two atoms combine together due to by some bond, that is covalent bond or ionic bond, a molecule can be formed. Now, then from the molecules, the whole organelles are formed. Organelles are nucleus, ER, that is endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi body, etc. Now, levels of organization of a living organism. Let's see that in that a cell. Cell is the basic unit of the living organism. It makes up all the organism. From the cells, the tissues are formed. A group of cells that perform the same function and have the same structure is known as tissue. Cells working together are known as tissues. Then comes the organ. The organs can be heart, brain, stomach, etc. Then from the organ, 2-3 organs combine together to make the whole organ system, means our digestive system, respiratory system, circulatory system. They are all made up of more than one organs, and they make the whole organ system, and this organ system makes the whole organism. This is the non-living levels of the non-living levels. As you can see, from atoms, molecules are formed, means from the periodic table, each and every atom forms the molecules, and from the molecules, the organelles are formed, means carbohydrates, the nucleotides, etc. make the whole organelles. Then in living, as we know, the first unit is cells, and then comes cells, where the life starts, and then different cells performing the function together, that is the tissues. Tissues then come and form organs. Different tissues, they form a single organ, and then organs form different organ system. Organ systems are formed by more than one organs. They together work to form the organ system, and then from all the organ system together makes the whole organism. Now the cells are mainly of two types, that is the prokaryotic cell as well as the eukaryotic cell. Let's look at each of them. Prokaryotic, that's the first cell that was delivered in the earth. The cells that lack a nucleus, nucleus is the central organelle, or the membrane bound organelles, are known as the prokaryote. It includes mainly bacteria, because first cell that was originated in the earth is the prokaryotic. So first was originated the primitive animal, that is the bacteria. It is the simplest type of the cell. It has single circular chromosome. It is the first cell type on earth. The cell types of bacteria and archaea are of this type. Then nucleoid, this is the nucleoid region, which is not nucleus. It is not well developed. It is just a coiled structure of DNA. Now the eukaryotics. Eukaryotes are cells that have a proper well-developed nucleus and a membrane-bound organelles. It includes protists, fungi, plants, animals. All these higher level organisms are made up of the eukaryotic cells. They have more complex type of cells. Now eukaryotic cell, as you can see, it is, has mainly basically three structures. That is a nucleus, as you can see in the center, the cell membrane that covers the whole cell, and the cytoplasm with the organelles in it. Now the two main types of eukaryotic cell. Now eukaryotic cell are divided into two main types, that is the plant cell as well as a animal cell. This is a representation of the plant cell, animal cell, and this is the representation of a plant cell. Now similarities, let's look at the similarities. Both have a cell membrane surrounding the cytoplasm, both have nucleus, and both contain mitochondria. Now the difference between the cell and the animal plant cell and the plant cell are: animal cell are relatively smaller in size, plant cell are relatively larger in size. They are irregular in shape. These have regular shape because of the cell wall. They have no cell wall, and this have cell wall, which gives it a regular shape. Now another difference is they have vacuoles that are very small, or the vacuoles are absent. These have large central vacuoles, means the vacuoles are very large in size. In this, the storage of food is in form of glycogen. Here the storage of food is in form of starch. Then here the nucleus is at the center, and here the nucleus is near the cell wall. Now what is cell wall? Because the lipid protein layer of the plasma membrane is less than 10 nanometer, they are very thin and it can be broken down easily. So it requires a cell wall that gives it a support, a rigidity to the cell. So it is expected to offer only minimal, the plasma membrane offers only minimal protection for the cells contains. So it is known as the naked cells, that are extremely fragile. Fragile means weak. The cells of all the nearly all organisms other than animals are expected to have this cell wall to give it rigidity. Protozoa have a thickened outer coat, where bacteria, fungi, plants have a distinct cell wall. The cell wall is tough, usually flexible, but sometimes fairly rigid layer that surrounds the some type of cells. It is located outside the cell membrane and provides the cell with the structural support and the protection, and also acts as a filtering mechanism. The major function of the cell wall is to act as a pressure vessel, preventing the overexpansion when the water enters the cell, that is osmosis. They are found in plants, bacteria, fungi, algae, and some archaea. Animals and protozoa do not have the cell wall. Now plasma membrane. What is plasma membrane? It is the ultra thin, elastic, living, dynamic, and selective transport barrier This is the example. It is the fluid mosaic assembly of the molecules of lipids, proteins and carbohydrates. This is the structure of the plasma membrane. This is the lipid layer and these are the proteins that are embedded in between. Let's see. This is the whole membrane component. These are the whole lipid layers and these are the two types of proteins, that is the peripheral proteins and the integral proteins. The lipids are of two types, that is phospholipids and cholesterol. These are the whole phospholipid layers which you can see, and in between are the cholesterol molecules. Now they have proteins that are of two types, integral and peripheral. Integral means it is present all over the membrane, while peripheral means it is present at the sites. And they have carbohydrate structures, receptors which are formed from glucose. This is the phospholipid. The whole bilayer of phospholipid is formed by this structure. It contains two fatty acid chains, as you can see. The head is a polar region and the tail is made up of the fatty acid, and the head contains the phosphate group, thus it is known as phospholipid. This is also the structure. Now the cell membrane is made up of two layers of phospholipid. It is a bilayer structure, and thus it is known as lipid bilayer. Hydrophobic molecules do not pass easily through this because it is made up of lipid, that is hydrophobic means water fearing, while hydrophilic, that is water loving, do not pass easily. Small molecules and large hydrophilic phobic molecules move easily, that is gases like O2, CO2, they can easily pass, as you can see, because they are hydrophobic, while hydrophilic, they repel against the plasma membrane, as you can see, because they are water loving. Ions, hydrophilic molecules are larger than the water, and larger molecules such as proteins do not move through the membrane on their own. They do not move through the membrane on their own. They get repelled. So they need some structures that are proteins that provide them channels to pass through them. This is the fluid mosaic, means they are in a fluidy structure, watery structure. This is a phospholipid bilayer and the proteins in between. Molecules in the cell membrane are constantly moving and changing because it is a fluid. Now the fluid mosaic model, fluid because the individual phospholipid and proteins can move from side to side, and like it's a liquid, so it is known as fluid. And mosaic because of the arrangement of the proteins in between. As you can see, proteins are arranged in the between. It makes a mosaic model. This is the cell membrane. The polar heads are hydrophilic, that is water loving, as I said before, while the non-polar tails are hydrophobic. These tails are hydrophobic, that is water fearing. So they are present inside the bilayer. Makes the membrane selectively in what passes. It selects what passes through the whole membrane. So it is known as selectively semi-permeable membrane. The functions are, it provides a protective barrier, it regulates transport in and out of the cell, what transports. It allows the cells to recognize. It provides anchoring sites for the filament of cytoskeleton. It provides a binding site for the enzymes. Enzymes are the biological catalyst. It helps in interlocking the surface, binds the cell together. Means two cells, they are binded together and form the junction, that is because of the plasma membrane. And it contains the cytoplasm. The fluid is contained inside the cell because of the plasma membrane.